This morning's shiur is Leili Nishmas, my mother's mother, Bun Levas Rav Zecharia Brun. She came over right before the war on the last boat out of Germany, and she was makbit to cover her hair when she came to America, and she sent her girls to Beis Yaakov and her boys to yeshivas, and Baruch Hashem, she raised a nice family. We're in Perek Tes, up to Pasuk Yud Dalid. Last week we discussed how Shaul, we were first introduced to Shaul officially in the Psukim. We had mentioned weeks ago that Shaul was the one, Chazal said, who grabbed the Luchos away when the Aron was captured. He grabbed the Luchos and he ran back to Shiloh. But the first time he's mentioned in the Psukim was at the beginning of Perek Tes. And his father lost the Asonos, the mules, and Shaul was the one who was sent to find them, and he wandered all around until he came to Shmuel. The Nar, the lad who was with him, said they should go to Shmuel. They went to Shmuel. Then we mentioned in Pasuk Yud Beis and Yud Gimel. I just wanted to elaborate a little on that. But they came and they met the girls and they asked, where is Hayesh Bozeh HaRoeh? Is the Roeh, the Shmuel here, who sees the future and sees all of the personal details of our lives, and he could possibly help us find these mules? And they gave him a long-winded answer, which we explained. The truth is every nuance had a meaning to it and had a lesson. But even so, it was a very long answer. And Chazal say from there that you see that women are dabronios, that they speak a lot. I just thought that was interesting to point out. Rav Huttner, in his Pachad Yitzchak on Pesach, discusses, of course, Pesach is the Yom Tov when we speak a lot. You have the mitzvah of Sipur Yetzias Mitzrayim and Lechem Oni. The matzah is the food on which we say over the whole Haggadah. Anyway, over there he just makes the point that among the klala that was given to Chava after she ate from the Eitz Hadas was Rashi mentions over there that not everything is a woman able to say. Therefore, it comes out, Rav Huttner explains that since certain things can't be said, you sort of have to beat around the bush, and that's why women speak a lot, because a lot of times they're given that nature not to speak directly to the point. But what I find interesting is, just like Adam had the klala that he had to work, and we all know that the Gemara says in Ksuvus that Batola Mevila De Shiamum, if a guy wastes his time and he sits doing nothing, he can literally go out of his mind. A person has to be busy. He can be busy doing nothing important, but he's got to be doing something. A guy who wastes his time, he can go crazy. So it happens to be that work is a klala. But for the average person, unless he's learning Torah, or unless he's involved in mice of tzedakah and chesed the whole day, but if a person's sitting and he doesn't have to earn a living, for most people, it's an early retirement is not good for them. It's not good. So it's a klala, and yet you see there's a strong benefit. I think it's the same thing with the Noshim Dabronios, that if a person's able to speak, like you find Navshi Yotza B'Dabroi, that a person's able to create a relationship and to bond with somebody if he shares his thoughts and his feelings. A person who's reticent and doesn't like to talk very often isn't able to build that closeness. So a woman, as the Akeres Habayis, it's critical that she should be able to converse and to talk and to discuss details, whether they're important or not so important. It's all part of creating the cement that bonds the family together. Be that as it may, that's their nature, and that's one reason why the Gemara identifies it was so long of a response. We're in Perek Tes Pasuk Yud Dalet. Vayalu Ha'ir, so Shaul and his Nar, the lad that was with him, they went up to the city. Hema Boim Besoch Ha'ir, they were coming into the city. Behinei Shmuel Yotzei Krosim, and behold, a Chiddush, Shmuel's coming out to greet them. Lalos HaBoma, to go up to the Boma where he had a mizbeach, he had an altar, and they were, he was going to bring a sacrifice, and they had a select group of people who were invited. Shmuel was on his way up, and yet he came out to greet them. They wandered around, we'll see in a moment, it was 3 days that they were wandering around looking for the mules. And they were walking here and they were walking there, and they themselves sensed that it was sort of bizarre to be looking in all these distant places for asonos, because a mule doesn't walk that far away. But they sort of felt compelled to walk to this district and walk to that country, county, and they were walking through all the areas till they came to Shmuel, because it wasn't yet time for Shaul to be made king. Now that it's time, things go quickly, and Shmuel comes out to greet them. Vashem golas ozen Shmuel. Hashem told Shmuel yom echad, a full day, lifnei bo Shaul leimor, before Shaul came, Shmuel was informed a day earlier. Ka'es mochar, at this time tomorrow, eshlach eilecha ish, I'm going to send to you a person, Me'eretz Binyamin, from the land of Binyamin. He wasn't identified by name. He was just told that he would be sent somebody from Binyamin. And it's a precise time, Ka'es mochar, at this time tomorrow. So he could have looked at his watch and seen exactly what time it was then. He knew that it was going to be 24 hours later. U'mishachtu l'nogid al ami Yisrael. And you should anoint him, pour this special Shemen HaMishcha to pour the oil on him as a sign of greatness. You should be Mosheachim Lenogi, that he should be a ruler, Al Ami Yisrael, over my people, Klal Yisrael. V'hoshias Ami Miyad Plishtim, and save my people from the Plishtim. Ki Reisias Ami, because I see my people, Ki Bo Tzakoso Eloi, the cry of the people has come to me. You notice he says Ami in that pasuk three times, because even though we'll see Klal Yisrael was a mistake that they asked for a king, and the Mefarshim also note the fact that the Plishtim seem to be in charge, the Klal Yisrael is feeling oppressed by the Plishtim, even though the Plishtim had a setback after they captured the Oron, and the Oron traveled around and they suffered from those painful hemorrhoids and the mice, and after they were punished, the Plishtim sort of let up. In fact, the Pesukim mentioned earlier, there were cities that were under the Plishtim control that reverted back to Klal Yisrael. But it seems that over the span of the ensuing years, the Plishtim again had gotten the upper hand and were oppressing Klal Yisrael. But even with all that, there's still that chiba that Hashem has for Klal Yisrael. Klal Yisrael was still on a very high level. Not as high as they could have been, should have been, but they were still, it was, there's a save my people. Ami is a lashon of, as opposed to right in yesterday's leining, kishiches amcha. If you say to Moshe Rabbeinu, your people's destructive. Here it's Moshias Ami, save my people. Kivot sakoso Eloi, because the cry of the people came to me. Simply, it means their cry that to be saved from the Plishtim. But in terms of saving them from the Plishtim, the truth is they didn't need a king. In other words, they could have had Shmuel as the shofet, as the leader. And during the shoftim, many times there were nisim that were done for Klal Yisrael to save them from the enemy. But Klal Yisrael felt that they didn't want to live under that type. They knew eventually when they came to Eretz Yisrael, as we've mentioned previously, they knew when they came to Eretz Yisrael there's a mitzvah to set up a king and to have the government running in the normal manner, with a monarchy, as opposed to relying on when Klal Yisrael has a problem, all of a sudden Hashem will choose a leader. He's the shofet. He saves them usually through, very often there were miracles that were done with few soldiers, and as in Sefer Shoftim it discusses how they won their different battles. And then after that shofet is nifter, a different shofet, when there's a problem, it is appointed. But they knew eventually when they come to Eretz Yisrael, they have to have a king. And there's supposed to be a normal, what you'd call a normal mode of government. And things work more b'derech ha-teva. And of course they knew HaKadosh Baruch Hu's Mashkiach and HaKadosh Baruch Hu's Kol Yochel and everything, but it's not done in a miraculous manner. Klal Yisrael cried out for the king. So the Pasuk could be saying, Voshias Ami Miyad Plishtim, save them from the Plishtim. But why you're appointing, the reason why you're making the king is because of crying out, they want a king. As the people felt they wanted a king, even though Shmuel was initially very upset about that. But if they want the king, give them the king, and the king will be the one who will help them, save them from the Plishtim. Ushmuel raw as Shaul. Shmuel saw Shaul. Vashem ano, and Hashem responded to Shmuel. This is the person that I mentioned to you. That ze yatzar v'ami. This one will be the one who will control, who will be the leader over my people. In other words, again, it's Shaul himself was, as we learned before, he was one of the greatest chachmei ha-Torah. His Torah knowledge was one of the greatest. Physically, he was mishich mulamalo. He was the head and shoulders above everyone else. He looked like the king. He was fit to be the king. Yet Shmuel never met Shaul. And Shaul never met Shmuel. Shaul didn't know who Shmuel is. Shmuel didn't know him. Even though they were two, it would have been expected. Shaul was already probably in his 50s. We already discussed our 60s. So Shaul was older, and yet he had never met Shmuel. But now when Shmuel sees Shaul, perhaps he said a tefillah, or the question was understood. It doesn't say what the question was. But the answer is, this person, Shaul, he's the one who's going to be the leader of Klal Yisrael. Zei yatzor ba'ami, the Targum says, zei yatzor, like he'll remove the yoke of the goyim from Klal Yisrael. Yatzor, like, hold back the goyim from having any control over Klal Yisrael. It could also mean zei yatzor is like a ruler, as Rashi brings down. When they go to war, the commander controls the troops that everyone should go where they're going, they're supposed to be going, and to conduct the battle, that everyone fills their role. Zei yatzor ba'ami, he'll control the people to do what they're supposed to. And others say even not in terms of war. The king is supposed to be the one to set the moral tenor of the people. If he guides Klal Yisrael to live properly, I'll be the Torah, and that everyone should keep the mitzvahs and live properly, they'll be safe from the goyim. That's the main purpose of the king, to use his authority to guarantee that Klal Yisrael should keep the Torah. And Shaul's the one, Zei Yatzor Ba'ami. Vayigash Shaul es Shmuel. Shaul approached Shmuel, the Soch HaShor, within the gates of the city. Normally it would say Vayigash Shaul li Shmuel, or El Shmuel. He approached to Shmuel. But as we mentioned, Shmuel here actually came out to greet him. They sort of met each other. Vayigash Shaul es Shmuel. Shaul met with Shmuel, because he went to Shmuel, and Shmuel was coming to him. B'soch HaShor, within the gates of the city. Vayomer, and Shaul said, Hagida no li, could you please tell me, Eze beis haroeh, where is the house of the roeh, the seer, the one who sees the future? Now that's a very neutral type of question. You know, if you're going somewhere and you don't know who somebody is, you can always say, you don't want to ask him directly, are you Shmuel? Or are you the roeh? That could be a very uncomfortable question. He doesn't know who Shmuel is. On the other hand, the way they sort of met, I guess he wasn't able to ask somebody else, is that Shmuel? They sort of met each other. So he asked them a question, where is the house of the roeh? Now, even if that Shmuel, asking the question in that manner, could convey the impression that, you know, he wants a house appointment. You know, maybe they should meet together in the house. So he spoke in third person. Instead of saying, where's your house? Where's the house of the roeh? And, you know, could be he'd like to meet in the house, or... So he asked it very... In a way that's very bakovedik, without asking directly on the spot, are you the roeh? Where's the house of the roeh? Vayan Shmuel Ashol. Shmuel answered Shaul. Vayomer, he said, Anochi haroeh. I am the roeh. That's a very direct type of response, and Chazal say that Shmuel shouldn't have answered like that. It's on the simple level, could be it's a shtickle, lefi his madrega, maybe it's considered a little bit of gaiva, like, you know, it's, I am the roeh. What do you mean, you are the roeh? HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives you the ability to see the future, to know people's details, but to take the credit as, that's me, I'm the roeh, could be was a bit of gaiva. I say, according to Shmuel, is madrega, the Mefarshim point out, we'll see this later on when we get to the way Shaul conducted his malchus. Shaul was the epitome of humility. And that feature was one of the things that made him the greatest in Klal Yisrael. We said at this point, at the point that he was chosen king, the Pasuk said, Ein ish mi b'nei Yisrael toiv mimenu. There was nobody better than him. He was the one who was unparalleled. Yet you find that he didn't even know who Shmuel was. He was going after looking for donkeys, looking for his father's donkeys. It's like he's an unknown. People didn't know who he was, and he achieved his greatness without it affecting him at all, and he was able to carry on his life like he was a regular person. Shmuel is letting him know, first of all, Anochi Haroe, that if the person's in control, you have to show that he's in control. I am the roeh, to show an example. If somebody's the leader, he has to know he's the leader. It could be it's also to tell him, Anochi haroeh, Shaul is going to find later on, like we'll see later with Amalek, he mentions that ki oreisi esa'om, the people wanted to save the animals, to bring as a carbon, and I didn't want to confront the people. And I was, this is what the people were going to do, and I sort of went along with that. Shmuel's letting him know, Anochi haroeh, meaning you're, we'll see in a moment, he hints to him that you're going to be the king. But a king has to know, it's an interesting balance. The Novi has to have covered for the king. Everyone, including a Novi, there's a mitzvah, Som Tosim Olecha Melech, you have to appoint the king, and there's a halacha in the Torah, you have to, his ema, his awe, the fear of the king, must be on the people. A king is not allowed to be moichel his kovet. If you don't want your children to stand up for you, you can be moichel. I'm not saying it's always the best idea, but a father can be moichel his kovet, a rebbe could be moichel his kovet, right? If you go to the Seder, and a person's with his rebbe, he doesn't have to lean. Because what, a Talmud should sprawl out in front of his rebbe? But if the rebbe says, I don't mind if you lean, so then the Talmud leans. By a king, there's no such thing. You can't be moichel your honor. The honor of the king is divinely mandated. So Shmuel was telling him, in other words, he's the king, and Shmuel's going to have covered, we'll see, for the king. On the other hand, Shaul must know Anochi haroeh. Shmuel is the roeh, and he has to be in guidance by the Nevi'im to know what to do. Or the king, Shaul here was chosen because he was the best. But his son would become the king, even if his son is not the best. And his grandson, and it's given over to Yerusha. So what becomes the Gadol Hador is no longer necessarily going to be the leader. The king is the king, and there's going to be Nevi'im who are going to guide the king and tell them what to do. So Shmuel spoke with a certain forcefulness, which he felt, Anochi haroeh, it's important that Shaul should know. And he spoke in general, we'll see, to Shaul in a forceful manner, to show Shaul that he has to know that he should feel there's another authority that he has to follow to. That's the authority of the Novi, who has the Devar Hashem. Other Mefarshim point out, Anochi haroeh. I remember when we used to go to Eretz Yisrael, so sometimes the Americans would want to ask directions to get to a certain place. And we'd try in our broken Hebrew to ask, you know, whatever sentence. And if the Israeli was on the ball and he knew English, we'd speak our broken Hebrew, and he would respond with a fluent English, you know, oh, you want to go there? You know, it's right down the road. It could be here also, that was the taina on Shmuel. Shaul didn't want to ask him directly, are you Shmuel? He asked him, where is the house of the roeh? So it's like Shmuel saying to Shaul, Anochi haroeh, why beat around the bush and ask where is the house? I'm the roeh. So it was a little bit of a put down. In other words, Shaul was trying to find out where Shmuel is without asking it directly. And Shmuel gave him a direct, blunt answer, Anochi Haroah. And Chazal mentioned Shmuel was given, as I say, these are minor faults, and it's sort of given a later on in history, when Shmuel is choosing the David HaMelech to be the king, he met the sons of Yishai, and he thought that Eliyahu would be the king, and he was told, no, not the way it appears to you, Ki Adam Royal Lainayev, Hashem Yirla Levov, not the way, you know, people see the way it looks to them, but HaKadosh Baruch Hu knows people's hearts, and the king is supposed to be David, not one of the brothers. But over there, because Shmuel had taken the credit, Anochi Haroah, he was told, not the way people see is the way it is. Hashem sees the hearts. He was given that hint that he's not the Roeh. In any case, Shmuel answered Shaul, Anochi Haroah, I'm the Roeh. Alei lefonai habama, go up before me to the bama, to where they had the Mizbeach, v'achaltem imi hayom, and you'll eat together with me today. It's in the plural, v'achaltem, you will eat. The Shaul and his lad. And we'll see that his lad also, you know, it's, I guess it's comparable to the person who drives the Rosh Yeshiva around. Sometimes he gets also put on that table. But the Nar was going together with Shaul, so the point is that Shaul should be given the position of honor, but the Nar came along with him, and the two of them will eat together with Shmuel. V'shilachticha v'aboker, and then I'll send you in the morning. V'chol asher b'levavcha agid loch, anything that's in your heart, everything that's in your heart, I'll tell you. Now he doesn't mean the mules, because that's the next pasuk. But everything in your heart I'll tell you, meaning Shaul must have had many questions in learning, or in Yerushalayim, or whatever you want to know. Shmuel saying, I can answer all the questions, but in the morning you'll be going back, you don't have to worry. Obviously they were concerned of getting back to tell Shaul's father that they're okay. Tomorrow morning you'll go back. V'la sonos ha'ovdos l'cha, and about the mules that you had lost, ze hayom shloshes hayomim, today it's already 3 days that they're gone, al tosem eslib cholahem, don't even put your heart to those mules. Kinim so, they were found. If you're walking down the street and you see a mule loitering around, you can assume the owner left it there to graze. That's good for 1 day, for 2 days. The Gemara says if it's already for 3 days, you see the mule and it's unattended, after 3 days you can assume it's lost. Now it was 3 days, and therefore they can assume it was, if they're still not found, they really are lost. But they don't have to worry. So they were found. But besides that, whether the mules are found or they're not found, Ulami kol chemdas Yisrael, who is the person who's going to get all of the desirable possessions of Klal Yisrael? Who's going to sort of own it all? Halo lecha, it's going to be yours, lechol beis avicha, and your whole families. Because the king, we learned before, the king has the right to take what belongs to others, what serves the malchus, eminent domain, but the king has the right to take others, and therefore he benefits and his family would benefit. So don't worry about the mules. Now he didn't say to him directly that he's going to be the king, but it was a very strong hint. Vayan Shaul Vayomer, Shaul picked up on the hint. Shaul called out and he said, Halo Benyamini Anochi. I'm a Benyamini. I come from Benyamin. Mikatane Shivta Yisrael, from the smallest of the Shvatim of Klal Yisrael. Umishpachti Hatzi'ira, and my family within the Shevet of Benyamin, there are many different families. My family in Binyamin is the youngest, Mikol Mishpacho Shivtei Binyamin, from all of the families of the Shvatim, the tribes of Binyamin. It was called tribes because the families of Binyamin parallel, since originally Yaakov originally Yaakov wanted Rachel to be his wife and build Klal Yisrael from Rachel, and of course we know it's together Rachel and Leah. But Binyamin was set up as if to correspond to the other tribes, as Binyamin in the Torah had 10 sons, and Yosef had 2, so that would have been 12 families, 12 tribes, just from Yosef and Binyamin. Yosef had 2 sons, and Binyamin was 10. But therefore, it was called, from all, my family is the youngest from all the families of the Shivte Binyamin, the tribes in Binyamin. V'loma dibarta elai kadover hazeh. Why did you speak to me such a great thing that I should become the leader? Now, he didn't say no, but he's wondering, how is he the one to be chosen? First of all, he's a Ben Yamini. Malchus normally goes to Yehuda. His strike was he was not from Yehuda, he was from Binyamin. I just wanted to mention, we touched on, and it's going to come up again, the Bar Benel discusses in the beginning of Perek Tes, the whole idea where the Malchus is supposed to come from. The Ramban says on the Pasuk, Lo Yosir Shevet Mi Yehuda, that the stick, the authority, will not be turned away, will not be removed from Yehuda. The Ramban says over there, Shevet means the stick of authority, means the king. That once we have a king from Yehuda, well, we're not allowed to have a king from other Shvatim. It belongs to Yehuda. In fact, the Ramban mentions the Chashmonoim, who he calls Chasidei Elyoin, and if not for them, Torah would have been forgotten. The Chashmonoim of Hanukkah, without them, Klal Yisrael, Torah would have been forgotten. They were tremendous tzaddikim. But what happened was, the Chashmonoim, after they won the war against the Yevonim, they became the kings. And because they became the kings, the Ramban mentions, that's why one after another of the Chashmonoim were killed, every single king. There were 4 of them that were killed afterwards. And eventually it reached the point where the whole family of Chashmonoim was wiped out. And there was a slave in the family, Hordus, who took over, and he proclaimed that he's from the Chashmonoim, and whatever, he took over as king. The Gemara says in Kiddushin, if you meet anybody nowadays and he tells you, he's got such a good yichus, he comes from the Chashmonoim. The Gemara says you should know that he comes from an Eved, he comes from Hordus. There is nobody, no pure Yid who comes from the Chashmonoim. The family was wiped out. And the Ramban says the reason is they were punished because they should not have maintained the Malchus. In other words, they won the war, and I guess possibly for an interim period, it was okay for them to be the leaders till things stabilized, but then they immediately had to give over the Malchus, because Malchus has to be by Yehuda. Lo Yosir Shevet Mi Yehuda. And that was the sin that even the Aseres HaShvatim should not have maintained their separate kingdom all those many years. The Abar Benel, interestingly enough, has many questions on the Shita, and he mentions all the Meforshim in Chumash learn like the Ramban. In other words, that's the understood, the mainstream approach. That's the way the Meforshim learn Lo Yosir Shevet Mi Yehuda means Malchus has to be by Yehuda. But the Abar Benel has a number of questions, and it's interesting. I find to notice the way the Abar Benel learns gives you an appreciation. You don't take the other opinion for granted. But there's, then you can, when you hear the questions, you can see how the Ramban would have answered it. But it's interesting to note. The Abar Benel says, first of all, Lo Yosir Shevet Mi Yehuda. Who said Shevet means a king? Shevet means a stick. Authority. And the Ramban brings certain psukim where Shevet seems to imply Malchus, but the Abar Benel argues with those psukim. He says Shevet doesn't have to mean a king. In fact, if Shevet means a king, so then you have the question, Vayhi Bishurun Melech is Poshup Shad, Vayhi Bishurun Melech means in Klal Yisrael there was a king, referring to Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu served as a king. And Yoshua ben Nun served after him as the leader of Klal Yisrael. This is, of course, with his assumption that Shevet means the leader, even if he's not the official king. But how could you have all the leaders of Klal Yisrael? How could you have all the shoftim were the leaders if lo yosur shevet mi Yehuda means the leader has to be from Yehuda? Now the Ramban says it means once you have a king from Yehuda, you're not allowed to have a different king. Or it's to make Shaul the king was allowed, because Shaul came around before Malchus Yehuda. But once you have the king from Yehuda, it's not allowed to go elsewhere. But Abarbanel asks, Osniel ben Kenaz, one of the shoftim, came from Yehuda, and afterwards the leader came from other shvatim. So it doesn't seem to be that the leader has to be from Yehuda. And it doesn't say lo yosur shevet Yehuda me'al echov, that Yehuda should be the leader over the other shvatim. It just says that Yehuda should be a leader. Now we'll see in a moment how the Abarbanel learns. The Torah, when it gives the mitzvah for appointing a king, it says soim tosim alecha melech, you have to appoint over yourself a king that HaKadosh Baruch Hu will choose. Mikerev achecha, he has to come from amongst Klal Yisrael. And then it says, lo sucha losis alecha yishnochri, you're not allowed to have a goy as the king. There was a famous king that the Gemara discusses, Agrippas, in the end of the second Beis Hamikdash, who was not fit, who was not didn't have the good yichus of a yid, and he wasn't allowed to be the king. But he happened to follow the chachamim, and he happened to do what he felt was right, and he was, I guess you'd say, a good king, but he wasn't allowed to be king. And when he used to read over that parsha at Hakel, he read Som Tasim Alecha Melech, he started to cry, because he realized he's not allowed to be king. And the Chacham placated him. And he happened to do what he felt was right, and he was, I guess you'd say, a good king, but he wasn't allowed to be king. And when he used to read over that parsha at Hakel, he read Som Tasim Alecha Melech, he started to cry, because he realized he's not allowed to be king. And the Chachams placated him, and they said to him, no, you are our brother. You are allowed to be the king. And they were wrong. You know, that was an example of Hanifus, but the truth is there was that feeling. He was a good king, but you're not allowed to have that. Losucha losis alecha yishnachri, you're not allowed to have a different king over Klal Yisrael. He has to be somebody from amongst us. So Abarbanel says if there's a din that the king must come from Yehuda, so why is the Torah saying you can't have a Goyish king? You can't even have a king from any of the other Shvatim. It has to be from Yehuda. Again, the Ramban could tell you that the Issa D'Oraisa is only on appointing a Goyish king. Or you are allowed to have a king before you get a king from Yehuda. But the other points, Shlomo HaMelech and his sons afterwards, the Malchus was split. With his, the Shlomo and his son Rechavim, they no longer merited to have the Malchus by them, so it was taken away, and it was given to Yerovim ben Nevat. Why was it given to Yerovim ben Nevat? If Malchus has to be by Yehuda, and there was something wrong with the family of David HaMelech, so it should have gone to a different family. Why did he choose a totally different Shevet and take Yerovim ben Nevat? It seems to be, again, that the Melech doesn't have to be from Yehuda. And the last time that Atabavano mentions is, the Pusuk says later on, when Shaul made a mistake, he was told, and Perek Yud Gimel, Ki ata heichin Hashem es mamlachtecha, Hashem established your Malchus El Yisrael over Klal Yisrael ad olam forever. You, Shaul, could have been the king forever. Va'ata mamlachtecha lo sakum. Now your Malchus won't last, Hashem gave it to David. The Abarbanel says it seems to be clearly from there. If Shaul would have been worthy, he would have been the king forever. The Pasuk, Lo Yosur Shevet Mi Yehuda, the Abarbanel learns a number of interesting explanations. First of all, Lo Yosur Shevet Mi Yehuda means that they'll always, the tribe will be leaders. The individual who's the king could come from any Shevet. According to the Abarbanel, the king could come from any shevet, but as a tribe, as a shevet, Yehuda is always the leader. Who's the ones who go out to war? Yehuda Yala. Yehuda is the one who leads the battle. Yehuda is the first one of the Degolim. In fact, when Klal Yisrael is counted, very often Yehuda is singled out. just to choose one example, in Perek Tes Vav, Pasuk Dalet, it says Shaul counted the people, and there were 200,000 foot soldiers, Vaseres Alof Mesish Yehuda, and there were 10,000 from Yehuda. Or Yehuda is very often mentioned separately, because Lo Yosu Shevet Yehuda means Yehuda as the Shevet that's leaders. Another explanation, Lo Yosu Shevet Yehuda, could mean Yehuda will always remain together as a Shevet, as a tribe, Ad Ki Yavo Shiloi, as the pasuk continues, until Mashiach comes. And then everyone, Velo Yikas Amim, and then everyone will gather around Mashiach that comes from Yehuda. Which, of course, as more and more centuries go by, it comes. As Aseres HaShvatim have been lost for a long time. It's already thousands of years. But the Aseres HaShvatim are gone, and yet Yehuda remains. Well, Yosef Shevet Yehuda. Yehuda will always remain as a Shevet. V'lo Yikas Amim, and when Mashiach comes, they'll all gather around Yehuda. Another pshat, Lo Yosef Shevet Yehuda, could mean the stick of punishment won't be removed from Yehuda. The Aseres HaShvatim, we mentioned this on the kinnis of Tisha B'Av. It's one of the very few kinnis we say at night. There's like two or three kinnis that are said Tisha B'Av at night. But it discusses like a debate between the Aseres HaShvatim and Yehuda, who suffered more. But the Aseres HaShvatim were exiled once, they're gone. Yehuda, we had one Churban, we had another Churban, again and again, and the Midrashim I mentioned about, you know, the Aseres HaShvatim are beyond the river of Sambatya, and it seems they're living okay, they're okay, living a tranquil life somewhere. But Yehuda, Lo Yosu Shevet Yehuda, they're always getting the stick, they have Yisurim, but U'mechoykik Mibein Raglov, and yet Torah is by Yehuda. Now it's Torah, as much as the Yisurim that Yehuda has, Shevet Yehuda is the one who has the Torah. Even certain people that are possibly from the Aseres HaShvatim that have been discussed, but they don't have Torah. Now, they might have certain practices and customs, and maybe they are from the Aseres HaShvatim, maybe not. That's a subject of debate. But they certainly don't have the Torah like we have. The Torah is a mechikik is by Yehuda. Therefore, the Abar Benel learns that Shaul was chosen to be the king, and he would have been the king forever, just because he made the mistake. The Malchus was given to David, but that has nothing to do with Lo Yosu Shevet Yehuda. But again, the Ramban and the other Mefarshim learn Lo Yosu Shevet Yehuda means once Malchus goes to Yehuda, it has to remain by Yehuda forever, Ad Ki Yavo Shiloi, until Mashiach comes. When we have a leader, when we have Malchus, the leader has to be from Yehuda. So Shmuel had told Shaul, you're the one, Ulamikol Chemdas Yisrael, all of the desirable things of Klal Yisrael are destined for Shaul and for his family. So Shmuel responded, hello, Benyamini Anochi. I come from Binyamin. So if I come from Binyamin, how could I be I'm not fit to be the king. And it's Miktane Shivta Yisrael. After the incident of Pilegesh Begiva, a story that's mentioned at the end of Shoftim, we seem to keep on coming back to that, but over there was a civil war, and the Shevet Yehuda was almost decimated. There were just a few hundred men left. They were wiped out. From that point on, Binyamin was Miktane Shivta Yisrael. It was scorned. Initially, nobody wanted to marry into Binyamin. In other words, they were ostracized. It was small in number, and it was not important. And Shaul realized if he becomes the leader, you know, it's like when the president wants to choose his running mate, he figures which part of the country he comes from, and, you know, it makes more sense, you know, if he's from the north, get somebody from the south. You know, you want to balance the ticket. Here also, if he's going to be a leader over Klal Yisrael, he has a very big disadvantage if he comes from Shevet Binyamin. The other Shvatim, that's a strike. Nobody wants a leader from Binyamin. Binyamin was the one who went to war against them. So he's mentioning he's from Binyamin, Miktane Shivta Yisrael, which is from the smallest of the Shvatim. Also within Binyamin, there's an Ben Yamini Anochi. Most of the Chachamim that we mention in Mishnayos have a title. Rabbi Yehuda, Rabbi Meir, Rabbi Yossi. There's a few who don't have a title. Ben Zoma, Ben Azai. And the Gemara says that they didn't have smicha. Even though they were from the greatest, and that was always the example, the Gemara will say, Hareini Kven Azai B'Shukei Tveria, when one of the Chachamim felt a certain sharpness and clarity of mind, he would sometimes remark, I'm like Ben Azai in the streets of Tveria, that you could ask him anything. Whatever questions you have, I can answer. And as Ben Azai was, they were from the greatest, yet they didn't have smicha. Exactly how and why is a question. But they didn't have smicha. And if it was just called Ben Azai, Ben Zoma, the son of Azai, the son of Zoma, and their name was Shimon. But it's a, in other words, if they're not great in their own right, they're referred to by their father. Shaul is saying, he didn't say, I'm Shaul. It's almost as if he's a no-name. Hello, Benyamin Yanochi, I'm the son of Binyamin. In other words, it's almost as if I don't have my own significance, I don't have my own prominence, I don't have smicha, I'm a Benyamin Yanochi. From the small shvatim, my family is from the youngest. V'loma dibarte like hadovra zeh. So why did you speak to me that I should be zeichet to such greatness? Shmuel didn't answer. What he said was the word of Hashem, and Shaul obviously realized that's the way it's going to be. Vayikach Shmuel as Shaul v'snaro. Shmuel took Shaul in his nar. Vayivim lishkosa, and he brought them to the room. Vayitin lahem mokom barosh hakruim. He gave them a place at the head of all those who were invited. This was a select group. This was not open to the public. There were about 30 people. So Shmuel had traveled around. He was coming back and he was going to bring this carbon. And there were 30 people invited to this special Seuda. Shaul's brought in and he's given a seat at the head, Barosh HaKruim, at the head of all those that were invited. Vayomer Shmuel HaTabach. Shmuel said to the Tabach, to the butcher, whatever, the head cook, right? Tanoes hamona, give that portion asher nasati loch that I gave you previously. Or Shmuel had previously designated a special portion. Asher amarti elecha, and I said to you, sim oisa imoch, keep this one with you. That was when you're preparing all the food, the meat from the karbonos, and the other food that was served, I gave you a special portion. I told you this portion should be put aside. Vayorem hatabach es hashok. The tabach lifted up the shok. Veheoleho, and what was on the shok. Or the shok is the leg of the animal. Lift up the shok, and what's on it, the meat. Vayosem lifnei shol, and he placed it in front of shol. And the Mefarshim mentioned, it's not just nowadays, but a waiter very often walks in, and you see the way he balances the tray on the palm of his hand, and his hand is above his shoulder, he carries it high up. It's mentioned here that's a sign of chashivas. When you're serving a portion, not just to walk in and slip the plate in front of somebody, but you lift it up high to show that this is a special portion. And that's what the Tavach did. By Yoram HaTavach, he lifted up the shok high to serve it with that dignity and formality, that this was a special portion. And he put it in front of Shaul. Vayomer, and he said, Hinei hanishar, this is what remains. Simo fanecha, place it before you, echol, and eat. Ki lamoed shomer lecha, for this set time, it's been guarded for you. Lemar saying, ha'om karasi, I've called the people, I've invited everyone. It's a very unusual, the syntax of the pasuk is very unusual. Vayochal Shaul im Shmuel bayomahu. Shaul ate with Shmuel on that day. The Malbim explains that when a korban shlomim was brought in the Beis Hamikdash, the chaza and the shok, the chaza is the part that's below the neck of the animal. I'm not sure what that cut of meat is, but it's below the neck of the animal, and the shok, the chaza and the shok, went to the Kohanim. And then the rest went, part of it went on, the first the fats were burned on the Mizbeach, then the Choz of Ashok went to the Kohanim, and if it was a Shlomim, and by Shlomim the owners ate the rest of the meat. What by a Bomas Yochid, meaning a private Boma, that was not the Beis Hamikdash, a Bomas Yochid, there was no tenufa, they didn't wave the Choz of Ashok, and it wasn't given to the Kohanim. But the very fact that this was the special part of the animal that was given to the Kohanim, it was a Choshava portion. So this is exactly what was designated to give to Shaul. And that's why the term is used, Hinei HaNishar. This is what remains. Because normally you'd put the fats on the Mizbeach, and then what was given to the Kohanim, like it says, Va'anoseres min ha-mincha, what remains was given over to the Kohanim. So V'hinei ha-nishor, this is the part that normally remains after the Mizbeach and goes to the Kohanim. And therefore, simo fanecha echol, place it before you and eat it, because you are sitting at the head and you are the leader, and therefore this is for you to eat. Because at the time that everyone was invited, kilamoi korosi, kilamoi shomer lechalemor, for this time, this piece was guarded for you. At the time that we'd say ha'am korosi, everyone's invited, this portion is designated for Shaul. So again, Shaul is being shown that he's being treated as the king to be. The word he'oleho is an unusual word. The simple meaning is the shok and the meat that's on it. But Chazal note the fact that the word is written like that, it alludes, there's a number of different explanations what it means. It could mean if you switch the ayin and the aleph, which very often are letters that are interchanged as if to make drushas, it would mean the shok and the alya. The alya is the fat tail of the animal. And that was a choice portion, again, a choice portion for Shaul. In fact, the Gemara in Pesachim on Daf Gimel has an interesting story. A guy once came to Rabbi Yehuda ben Beseira, and he boasted that he would go up to Yerushalayim for Pesach, and find a group of Yidden who were bringing the Korban Pesach, and he'd say he'd like to join their group. And they'd tell him, well, sure, you join the group, and you have to contribute whatever amount of money, probably, and you got to join in, and you're part of the group, make sure you're tahar, and you're ritually clean, whatever, and join the group. Anyways, this guy would always put on, pretend that he was Jewish, and he would join the group. So I came to Rabbi Yehuda ben Beseira, who lived far away in Netzivim, and he told him, I went to Yerushalayim, and I got to eat the Korban Pesach. So Rabbi Yehuda ben Beseira said to him, did you tell them, next year when you go up for Pesach, tell them you want to eat the tail. The fat tail of the sheep is a choice piece of meat. Tell them you want the aliyah. Anyways, so he went up the next year of Pesach, and he told the people, sure, he's joining the Korban Pesach, and he contributed, and they gave him a piece of meat. She said, how come you never give me the aliyah? You never give me the tail. You always give me a different piece of meat. So they said to him, who gave you the idea to ask for the aliyah? All of a sudden, this year you wake up and you want the aliyah. Oh, who gave you this idea of wanting the aliyah? So I told them, Rabbi Yehuda ben Beseira. So they really chapped the aliyah, the tail of the Korban Pesach was brought on the Mizbeach. In other words, it was a trick. Nobody ate the aliyah. The aliyah was put on the Mizbeach together with the fats of the Korban. So they got so if Rabbi Yehuda ben Beseira told this person to ask for the aliyah, they immediately discovered this ruse of his, and they discovered the trick, and they dealt with him accordingly. But the Gemara discusses what happened. But the aliyah, the tail, was a special thing that, a person can come with a complaint. How come you never gave me the aliyah? You always give me a different cut of meat. So Shaul was given the shoik, veheoleho, and the aliyah. Also, it can mean veheoleho, what's above the shoik, the yorech, the thigh, which is above the shok, and that would show the yorech, the thigh bone, is I don't know if that's the word for it. It's the animal that has three segments of legs. I mean, the humans have two, but the animal has three. The yorech is above the shok. I don't know exactly what that the bone is called. But the yarech is what the animal runs with, to show that the king's got to be the one to run in front of the people and to lead them. And another pshat is, it could be vehel leho, what goes on the shok, is again, the chaza went together with the shok. The two went together. And by saying vehel leho, what's on it, he's being merames to the chaza, which was the part of meat below the neck, which is to show that the heart of the people, that Shaul has to have the bold heart to lead the people in battle. So it was a choice piece of meat, and it alluded to different messages and different points that the king would, different roles the king would have. And that was served to Shaul. Vayochal Shaulim Shmuel b'yomahu, Shaul ate with Shmuel on that day. Vayerdu mehaboma, they went down from the boma hayir to the city. Vayedaberim Shaul al hagog, and Shmuel spoke with Shaul on the roof. It doesn't say exactly what they discussed. Rashi says that they discussed, he was mochiach him and he taught him Yiras Hashem, to get ready for his new role in life. He was given an extra dose of Yiras Shamayim. Some of Horsham say he was given, told how he has to lead the people. Vayashkimu, they got up early. Vayik Halois HaShachar, it was around Halois HaShachar. And Vayikra Shmuel, El Shol Hagog Hagogo Lamor. Shmuel called Shol to the roof saying, Kuma, get up, Vashal Cheko, and I'll send you on your way. They were actually both up before that, but they were sleeping in different places. They got up early, they had a sleepless night. Shmuel was thinking exactly how he's going to be Mosheach, how he's going to anoint Shaul and make Shaul the leader. And Shaul had a lot of things to think about. The very fact that he was given that hint to Mikol Chemdas Yisrael, that all of the desirable things in Klal Yisrael are going to end up by him. He was given a seat at the head of all the guests. He was given the choice portion. It was pretty evident that he was the one. He wasn't directly told, you're the king, but he assumed probably that was what was going to be. So they both got up very early. Afterwards, at Alois HaShachar, and as they were up before then, afterwards at Alois HaShachar, Shmuel called Shaul again to the roof, and he said, Kuma, get up, Vashal Cheko, and I'm going to send you on your way. Vayokam Shaul, Shaul got up, Vayetsu Shneim, and they both went out. Who? Shmuel. Shaul, together with Shmuel, Hachutza, they both went outside. And the Mefarshim mentions he had already met with Shaul, and he had already shown Shaul that he was going to be the leader and the main one. Now what he did was, he went Hachutza outside where everyone could see the closeness that Shmuel felt to Shaul. The two of them went together for a stroll in the town. Shneim hu, Shmuel Shaul, together with Shmuel, went walking achutza in the streets. Everyone should see how Shmuel cares and he has this closeness to Shaul. Hema yordin b'ketzei ha'ir. They were going down by the edge of the city. Shmuel omar el Shaul. Shmuel said to Shaul, Emor lanar, tell the nar v'yavor lefaneinu, and let him go ahead of us. Let him go ahead. He didn't tell, the truth is Shmuel could have told him directly. Shmuel could have told the Nar, please go ahead, I have something private to discuss. But you see from here that if a Nar, the lad, was the servant of Shaul, Shmuel didn't want to undermine that authority. As he told Shaul, you're this man's boss, you tell him to go ahead. As I don't want to give him instructions, he's your Nar. So you see the Sderach Eretz that Shmuel said to Shaul, you instruct him to go. And it doesn't say that he said anything. Vayavor, the Nar probably heard it. He heard Shaul tell Shmuel tell Shaul, tell him to go ahead. So Vayavor, the Nar went ahead by himself. And he went at a distance. Some learned Vayavor, he went further than he would have gone. Va'ata amod kayoim, and Shmuel now said to Shaul, you stand here kayoim like today. Which is a lashon, like today is, first of all, you have, and Parshas told us, when Yaakov said to Esav to sell the Bechorah, he said, Michro kayoim es Bechoros choli, and Hishov ali kayoim. If you say to swear or to sell, say or to sell something like the day, shows with all its brightness, with all its clarity and clearness. He says, V'ata amod kayom, stand here like today, meaning you're about to be chosen as the king, and it's a remez that when we're officially choosing you as the king, it's being done in the daylight, it's being done at a bright hour for Klal Yisrael. Some of Horsham say that's why he took him to the roof, to show that it's a good simon to be on the roof, showing like he's elevated above the crowd. V'ata amod kayom, stand like today, v'ashmiachos devar elokim, and I'm going to let you know the word of Hashem, and we're going to see in a moment, in Perek Yud, that Shaul will be chosen to be the king. For sponsorship opportunities, please call 718-436-3024. Thank you.